Welcome back. It's still Plots Politics. The Independent National Electoral Commission had said that the All Progressive Congress may not participate in the October governorship election in Ondo State. The commission said it does not honor the letter sent by the APC notifying it of the conduct of its primary in Ondo State because it observed that only the acting national secretary of the APC signed the letter notifying it of its primary in the state. Joining us to discuss this is Isaac Kekemeke, who is a governorship aspirant in the state, and also Liberals Oshoma, who is still with us in the studio. Good evening, once again.
Yeah, my pleasure.
And let me say hi to our friend from Ondo State, Mr. Isaac Kekemeke. Good evening. Okay, we'll come back to you. Let's quickly look at this legal issue again. We have you in the house. Let me quickly put it on record that the newly appointed caretaker chairman has already written to INEC to say that, okay, we didn't get it right in the first time.
No, they wrote introducing the new caretaker members and then also now
the
fix
the secretary.
Also now fix 20th of July. As the date for the primaries in Ondo State, signed by Governor Buni, who is the new chairman of the caretaker committee, and then Senator Akpan Oduedere, who is the secretary.
Yeah, the senator from Akwa Ibom. But let's just quickly look at some of these legal somersaults that our politicians engage themselves before we come to the current reality, because we want to focus on Ondo State and what is happening in APC Ondo State. But let's look at that. Why would they take that kind of step? I recall very well when the issue of Ondo State was happening that INEC reminded them that we only recognize the national chairman and the secretary for us to have correspondence.
When all of this happened, because of quest for power, Victor Gyadom, who claimed to be the acting chairman then, wrote a letter to INEC. And so INEC refused to recognize that letter, claiming that he's still, in their books, he was still the acting national secretary of the party and not an acting chairman, and that nothing, you know, had advised them to recognize him as such.
That's true.
And so on that ground, that they were not going to recognize just any document coming from anybody claiming to be acting chairman of the party. And so because if you look at even the first order that empowered Victor Gyadom to become an acting national chairman, it was an order made in vacuum. You don't use interim order to create a right that is non-existent and then now use that same interim order to seem to protect that same right that you have created. Mm-hmm. An interim order is an injunctive relief that is granted to protect an existing right.
That's true.
But in this case, there was no right in existence. The court created the right and then now seems to use an injunctive relief to, you know, protect it. But be that as it may, there was another court order also that purportedly suspended that same Victor Gyadom. So at that point, INEC was at a loss as to which one to take. And so they just said, you know what, we're going to maintain status quo as it were, and so we would not recognize this letter coming. And if IPC does not put its house in order, then we can as well just say, well, there is no government in power in APC. And and that was what happened against the backdrop of what played out in Zamfara. But that was where you can say that this political solution that they had taken would give them, you know, a reprieve for a few minutes or a few days,
at least pending where the fireworks. Elections.
Pending when the fireworks will start again, maybe after the election. You know, so what they have done now is to quickly write to INEC to say, we're conducting primaries on the 20th of July, and so I invite you, by the virtue of the Electoral Act, to come observe that primaries, and it ends there.
Beautiful. Let's remove the garment of a legal mind now and come straight to a political analyst. Let's look at what is happening in Ondo State. We just don't want to bring our searchlight on Edo.
Yeah.
Now, Ondo State is also going to happen almost a few weeks after we have a Edo election.
Yeah.
And APC seems to be
a house divided against itself.
You know, in the news. Before we even go into the fact that the deputy had already gone to PDP and is refusing to even, you know, relinquish his position. Let's even start with that. The deputy governor's aides were sacked, and the man reappointed his aides again.
That means
is there any illegality in that?
That means he will have to pay those aides from his pockets.
Because they are under the governor.
Yes, sir, because every aides of... and that is why even Lalo Akonde, who is the chief press secretary to the vice president, is addressed as chief press secretary to the president because he was appointed, you know. Even though he was appointed by the vice president, it is subject to, you know, appointment from the office of the president.
So where's the definition of the governor, joint ticket issue?
Yes, the deputy governor is only carries out functions that are delegated to him by the governor. And so that's why the governor can hire and fire his aides as he likes. And so once the aides are fired, their names are removed from the, you know, the financial books of the state. And so if you decide to appoint them back, that becomes a subject of litigation because they won't get salaries. And then, you know, how is he going to pay them from his pocket? Or, you know, so that's why for me, I think really the Supreme Court had said the mandate belongs to a political party. We don't have independent candidates here. You can't run an election on the platform of your name alone. It must be on the platform of a political party. And so to that extent, if you have any disagreement with the political party, no matter how, you know, morally bankrupt the political party is, you do not tenaciously hold on to, you know, that mandate or the office, especially against the fact that
what was the case between Atiku that was cited and that of Obasanjo?
All of those, what
because
happened,
he stayed in as it, the
it
vice
was,
president.
It was the same thing that what I'm saying, legally speaking, you can only be removed from office when you are impeached. You cannot,
the
governor
the
can sack.
National Assembly.
The governor cannot sack
his deputy.
What Obasanjo attempted to do was to use administrative panel of inquiry to disqualify Atiku from running for the office of the president. And so Atiku went to court. In this case, what I'm saying is, our politicians, if you think you are popular and you have decided to leave your party on whose platform you rode to office, what you should do is, you know, to relinquish that position and, you know, since you have moved to a new party, go build your political, capital in that party and leave whatever, you know, it is. But what they do, they still want to remain in this other party and act as spoiler. And that's why they will tell you, oh, you just sit down there and talk. You are not, you know, a political activist. So you don't know the way the game is played. That reminds one also of what happened between Ajasin and Omobori Owo. Yes, in the same Ondo State. In 1983, it was the same thing. Omobori Owo feeling that, you know, he wasn't, he was relegated. And Ajasin, you know, was taking all of the positions. And eventually, you know, he left the party to run for office against his former governor. And we all know how it ended. And that those times were the days where you had, tribunals who would sit on Monday and by Saturday they were delivering judgment. But, you know, these days is different. An election is still it's a bit far away, you know, from now. So all of these crises for me are unnecessary. If ambition do not, you know, ride our political, you know, firmament and space, what is at play here is ambition of the governor and the deputy governor. So the deputy governor will probably feel he's the political bigwig behind the movement, and that the governor was just a legal practitioner who was brought on board.
Liberals, the deputy governor may have given up that, forget the ticket, I can get the ticket if I stay in APC. But there are forces within APC, and one of them is the person that we expect to join us, that's Isaac Kekemeke, who is a governorship aspirant. I just want to bring in this, then you can continue your thought. We have it from that report that about 80% of the leadership in APC are saying that Akeredolu should not go for second term.
Yeah.
And their reasons is not just about performance. They are looking at the rotational order.
Yeah.
And if time permits me, I will mention some of them to you.
Yeah, two things. While I agree that if you come to office on the platform of a political party, the moment you you leave that party. You should leave their mandate. But also, it is not also in our law books for that, you know, person to be browbeaten out of office the way they are currently doing, the deputy governor of Ondo State. Yes, if the majority of the party members do not want the governor to come to office for a second term, the national party, it's a national party, the national executive body of the party, you know, will determine the mode of primaries, be it direct or indirect. And so if the deputy governor feels that majority of the members of the party are with him, the best thing he can do is to take a form and, whether direct or indirect primaries, you know, also test his popularity in the party. You know, because this idea of moving to a different platform, when you move there, money is going to be spent. Structures are already there. People have been oiling those political machineries. And you don't just come take it from them. They are also going to demand for the funds that they have spent to oil those political machineries. These are state resources. And so that is why the election is so expensive, that when you eventually get there, the first thing you want to do is to recoup all of the money, the properties you have sold, to oil this machinery. And then Akeredolu was not a politician in the first place. If you remember, the first time he was...
NBA president?
No. The first candidate then that the ACN used to test waters in Ondo was this former court marshal. By the end of the day, he didn't see the light of the day. And then Akeredolu was brought on board from his legal practice, you know, aided by these big wigs of the party in the Southwest. And if the people also are not happy with his performance, and they also they are looking at rotation, which for me is something that if care is not taken, it will destroy our politics. Because this idea of, we seem to leave, you know, the issue of development and hang on tenaciously and selfishly to the issues of rotation. Oh yes, it's our turn. And so when that is our turn, is, you know, thrown up, we completely neglect and forget about the issues of development. Only for us to turn around later to say, well, oh, this one performed better than this. And that
if I can get you clearly now, what do you think is the issue with Akeredolu? Is it about his performance, or is the fact that the Ondo people subscribe to rotational governorship?
If you're talking about rotational governorship in Ondo, Akeredolu is serving his first term in office. You know, is on the platform of the APC. The governor in Ondo before Akeredolu was
Mimiko.
And
sorry,
was
let me help you
PDP.
With this. Let me show you. Let me show you this figure. Maybe this will help you. Now, Ade Farati is from Ondo North, and he was there for 1999 to 2003. He didn't do 8 years. That's their calculation. Oh. And we have Agagu from South. He was able to do more than 4 years. He did 6 years. That's another senatorial district. And we have Mimiko from Central. So the North is saying, let us come back. Now we have Akeredolu from Ondo North, who, as in their words, has completed the 8 years of the North. He should go.
See, the question is, the question should be, Akeredolu has come. What did he campaign? What were the planks of his campaign? Did he campaign on the basis of rotational governorship? Or he campaigned on the basis of delivering, the dividends of governance, of good governance to the people? And so he should be assessed, not on the basis of rotation, but on the basis of how has he been able to reach out to every nooks and cranny in terms of development.
Wow.
Mind you, Mimiko was in a different political party. And he contested on the platform of Labour Party and later joined PDP. He was in PDP before, moved. And then, I am also not taking away all of the intricacies that and the court cases that Jegede, Itayo Jegede, SAN had to go through
from PDP,
that denied him, saying is the light of the day in the election in PDP then, orchestrated by, you know, some external forces who were sympathetic to the APC. And so, if this is the time for the PDP to take their comeuppance from the APC, they would also want to gladly do it. But APC should learn better, knowing fully well that they use the same whip and the same method.
Wow.
Okay, Oke, if you remember,
Olushola Oke,
you know, also, if Olushola Oke in that election had aligned, possibly, you know, he probably with Eyitayo.
Eyitayo Jegede.
Akeredolu probably wouldn't have won the election. And okay. So that is why the parties need to also understand the meaning and purpose of aligning okay. in every election. Otherwise, the house divided against itself will not stand. And so if at this early hour, the APC house is already divided against itself with the deputy governor and the governor, you know.
And also within the APC horns, now.
Locking horns. And then APC at the national house is going through the same crisis. Then they need to watch it because okay. the PDP might just be watching in the lock. And they might even, and that's why the deputy governor would also Liberals, want to remain in the office because he probably wants to use his people to act as spoiler
beautiful.
From within.
Liberals, we hope to have you over and over again to continue this conversation because the conversation has just begun. Thank you so much, Liberals Oshoma, a legal practitioner, a public affairs commentator, and I'm also a political pundit. Thank you for your time.
My pleasure.
Yeah, we'll take a short break, and when we come back, I'll be giving you my take. Look at this Plus report.
The Nigerian police has arrested and paraded 39 suspects linked to various crimes, including armed robbery, kidnapping, castle rustling, and gun running. While parading the suspects in Abuja, the public relations officer of the police force, Frank Mba, stated that the police will continue to liaise with other sister security agencies to strengthen efforts towards curbing the menace of crime in the country. Mba also assured that the police will double efforts to deepen strategic partnerships with community leaders and other stakeholders to ensure communities key into the mandate of the police.
In one of the most disturbing cases we have here, three women aged 30, 25, and 21 years respectively were arrested for a failed attempt to move a total of 818 rounds of live ammunition all the way from Kano to Bayelsa State.
With these quantity of arms, you can wreak massive havoc to any community. This is a half bag of rice that contained the entire recovered arms. One of the suspects, stand up, had a very clear message on her t-shirt saying good things take time. It is ironical that right on her body, she is actually sending the very message that we are sending today. How I wish prayer had hearkened to the very advice that she is sending to us by wearing this t-shirt and telling us that good things take time.
Here is my take. Call it political solution and you might be right, but is it a legal solution? Legal minds, including my guest in the studio today, foresee some kind of political turmoil and even legal fireworks in the coming days. So many questions are hanging in the balance as many party loyalists have been directed to stay mute. But whether they speak or not, the ruling party should remember that the opposition is waiting to cash in on their internal wrangling. In all these politickings and power plays, it is obvious that there is a fierce contest for the position of President Muhammadu Buhari's successor. The president's words that he is not going to get involved in who succeeds him will be tested in the coming days, including the supposed intervention in the party's crisis. However, the worry is the desperation and shenanigans that have greeted the race for supremacy, which is similar to the drama that played out in the PDP, which resulted in the loss of presidency. Since our political class has refused to learn from history, can we, the people, be resolute on our choices of who govern us? Can we place premium on quality and selfless leadership that will take us to the next level? Yes, I mean next level, which is clear departure from the avarice and greed by the few. Let's ponder on these. And that's our show for tonight. Thank you for joining us on The Conversation. Until next time, stay safe. My name is Kayode Ladeinde, saying bye for now.